Great. Well, thanks everyone for being here. So Joanna had a great lead-in right now to talk about connection and the importance of this being, I guess, if you think about the Avengers being assembled, this is a new first year of the Avengers, right? Like, a lot of us are just getting to know each other. I met a bunch of people just for the first time today. So what does that mean in terms of how we work together? And there's a challenge here. Whenever there's more than one person involved in trying to get something done, you have to have connection. Nothing happens if you're not connected. If you're just by yourself and you want to do it, that's great. You can just shovel the dirt or build the brick wall. You can do whatever you want. But if you have more than one person, you have to have a strong connection. So that's the number one reason we're going to talk about connection today. When I was in conversations with Luis and Joanna about maybe what an initial topic was, connection was sort of kind of the obvious one. And what event do we have coming up soon where connection is going to be very important?
Meet the board.
Meet the board, right? So think about someone in your life that you have a strong connection with, right? It doesn't matter whether you've seen them a week ago, an hour ago, a year ago, but when you come together, you're laughing, your timing's perfect, and you're just connected so strong. Just take a moment and think about that person. Does everyone have that person in mind? And think about how they make you feel, right? Think about the feeling in your being when you're with that person. Okay? All right. Now, think about a person who's the opposite. No matter what you do, they interrupt you. You don't understand what they're saying. You can't get on the same page as that person. That's probably easier to think of, right? So does everyone have that person in mind? Right? And there's probably a lot of people like that in your life. And they're not all necessarily that important to you. It might be like the cashier at, you know, the local Target you go to or something. It doesn't have to be like your parent or your best friend, right? So now imagine if you could shift that so every person you met had that good feeling, that strong connection. Think about how that would change your experience of life and how you move through life. Would that be helpful? Right? Beyond the board meeting, just in life, that would be so wonderful if we could have strong connections with our children, parents, coworkers, bosses, team, and just the random person that you meet out on the street. Let's say you're on vacation, and you're like, wow, I met this wonderful person on vacation, right? So those are the principles we're going to explore today, the principles of connection. I have two promises for you. One, this training or presentation is going to be different than any other you've done before, all right? And you'll find out why in just a second. And the second promise I have for you is you're going to leave here with a different sort of concept of connection. Right? Like the way you think about, like, well, I connect with this person because, or I don't connect with that person because. We're going to sort of try to shift that and share with you a new perspective. Sound good?
Great.
All right. So there's three principles, and Luis knows this from I had presented for HLN. It's also in my book on charisma. But there are three principles I'm going to go over today, and we're going to practice that deal with connection. And the first one is be vulnerable, right? Now, you may be thinking, you know, there's a lot of people here at, you know, kind of big companies, right? Competitive companies. And you may be thinking, Joe, connection might work in the soft and cuddly workplace that you work in, but where I work, there's sharks in the water. You cannot be vulnerable, right? And the word vulnerable actually comes from a Latin word which means to wound, right? But there's also a lot of people here in finance and business. And finish this sentence for me. No risk, no reward, right? So you can be in your shell, and you can be invulnerable, and no one will hurt you, but you'll never connect with anyone either, right? So I can talk to you for an hour about the concepts and principles, but what I find is when you physically demonstrate this, it's much more effective. So if everyone could just pair up, we're gonna do a quick demo. So everyone pair up and stand an arm's length across from each other. So, and if someone doesn't have paired up, you can come and I'll pair up with you if you don't have a pair.
You got a
partner?
Okay, I'll be your partner.
Okay.
Who's next for the photo?
I mean, we do have to take pictures.
So I guess Casey and Joe?
Yeah, come on.
Oh, cool.
All right.
We're just pairing. He hasn't given instructions yet.
All right.
Although, Joanna,
yeah.
I don't know if
All right, so is everyone paired up?
Yes.
Okay, so what I want you to do is stand about arm's length apart and decide who's going to go first, okay? So the principle here is connection is where you meet in the middle, don't do this yet, and like shake hands, right? But you're a little far apart now to do that. So that's connection, right? Like symbolically connection, we're apart now, right? So I want whoever goes first, you can go first, to put your hand up like a sword and put it up in the other person's face. Oh. Like just a couple inches away. No, just one person. Just one person. Okay? Okay? So the person who has the hand in your face, how do you feel?
Like I'm going to kill him?
Yeah, right? So are you going to come in?
This is a little aggressive.
Are you gonna come in and try to shake hands with this person? Are you going to do that? No. Right? Keep the hand up. What are you more likely to do when someone sticks their hand in your face like that?
Smack your hand.
Smack the hand, or what else? How are you going to respond?
Back up.
Or you're gonna. So everyone, put your hand up.
You're gonna come after her.
Right. So now look at what we have here. Do we have any chance of connecting in this formation?
No.
Right? Why? We're gonna kill each other. Right? So what has to happen in order for us to connect?
The hands need to come down.
Yeah. So, but whose hand needs to come down?
Oh.
Yeah, exactly. You can only control your own hand, right? So the person who went first, put your hand down, right? Now I feel much safer because there's no hand in my face. So what can I do now? I can put my hand down, and now what can we do?
Shake hands.
We can meet in the middle and shake hands, right? All right, great. Great job, everyone. So that's what connection and vulnerability is all about. And we don't stick our hands in each other's faces, but emotionally and verbally, we kind of do that, right? Say, how you doing? Oh, I'm doing all right. And then you go back to your phone, you know? Can I ask you a question? Oh, I'm busy now. Oh, how's your family doing? Oh, it's fine, right? We kind of push each other away, and we don't really want to reveal that. So how do we put this into practice, right? Because concepts are good, but we need effectiveness, right? So I'm going to share with you something called the vulnerability spectrum, okay? So what it is there's five different levels of statements you can make that reveal vulnerability to someone else. And the more vulnerable the statement is, do you think the connection gets stronger or weaker than with the other person?
Stronger.
Stronger, right? So we're not going to share the most vulnerable one because that's the one that happens like 1 a.m. in the morning, you've had too much to drink, or maybe you make a confession to your spouse or significant other. We're not going to go there, all right? But I'm going to explain that level as well because it's part of the spectrum. So there's five levels, and there's two categories. And the first category is more thought-based, right? It's sharing what you think, right? So it's called transactional, right? Everyone here knows what a transaction is. So it's more transactional statements. So the first one is just talking about sort of social niceties. And I like to, it's called phatic, the word's not important, but I like to think of it as like in a lobby. You know, you meet someone in a lobby and you say, hey, what's up, how you doing? Right? I don't really expect a response from him, right? It's a social nicety. How strong is the connection when I say, what's up, how you doing? It's not strong at all. And you don't really expect it to be strong, right? It's just a social nicety. The second level of connection is called factual, and that's more like you are in orientation, right? You know, like when you're in orientation and you do like an icebreaker and people are like, you know, what town are you from? How long have you been at the company? You're just revealing something about yourself. It's personal, but it's not really personal. It's a fact, right? How old you are, what town you're from. So how strong is the connection there?
Not very strong.
Strong is a personal statement.
Not strong, but you have a chance, right? So like if I say like I went to Temple and you went to Temple, all of a sudden we have something in common, right? So there's a chance. So it's a little bit stronger than how you doing, how's everything going, right? So the third level is more evaluative, right? Where you actually give your thoughts on something. Right, so you say, this is the restaurant I like, this is where I like to eat. right? So let's try that one, all right? Let's go around real quickly in each of us. Share a statement that you might say in a conversation about a team you like, or food that you like, a restaurant where you love to go on vacation, right? So I'll go first. The last place we went on vacation is Universal Studios Orlando, because we're huge Harry Potter fans. Okay, we'll just go around real quick.
There's a Mexican spot around the corner from me called Blue Corn, and I love their tacos.
Great. John.
On my free time, I like to do yoga and CrossFit.
Nice.
In my spare time, I like to do poetry.
Great.
I actually am a really big fan of the wood spot here at Rutgers. It's called Wings Over. So if you guys know, so I'm working with Wings Over.
Great. Can we go to the back over here? Natalia, was that?
So I love to travel, and one of the things my family does as a tradition is every New Year's we spend in a new city somewhere around the world.
Great. Nivola?
I am constantly watching Netflix and watching, I rewatched The Wire twice in the last 12 minutes.
Great. Thank you. Carmen? All right, awesome. Party at Carmen's house. Next.
The last place I went on vacation, sorry guys, my voice is fine, is Colombia, which we try to do every year or 2 years since we saw Colombia.
You see that connection starting a little bit right there? Okay.
Yeah, we have three Colombians.
Yeah.
I'm a half Colombian, so. Hey everyone, I'm a big foodie and I love traveling. Recently, I've gotten I've tried to step away from the common ones like Italian, Asian food, Spanish food, and I'm on a big Mediterranean vibe. Greek food is something I like a lot.
Okay, did you go yet, Luis?
Last place I went to was Dallas over the holidays.
Nice.
So that was fun to hang out there with the kids, and I love to travel and go to new museums. That's always my favorite thing.
Excellent. Great. Humberto?
When I'm now, at work working on, spreadsheets, outside of work, I like working with my hands. So, I dabble in a lot of construction projects on the side.
Okay, great. Last but not least.
I love sports, so can't wait for the Super Bowl. I'm a Nets fan, Broncos fan, and Yankees fan. So.
Great. So you can see in this room, maybe you didn't connect with every single statement. Right? But I'm sure there was at least one person that now you feel like you might want to have a follow-up conversation based on something they said. Or even if you don't, you have something in common now, right? Because these are all kind of human things that we share in common, right? So you can see how we started out, very casual, you're in the lobby, how you doing, what's up? No connection, right? You'd be lucky. It'd be a miracle if you formed a connection from that. Then we went to more a fact, where you live, maybe a connection, what school you went to, how many years you've been working, but nothing too strong there. This level here, this last one, you're starting to really get into something, right? You're really sharing something about the way you think about something, right? So now we're gonna take things to the next level. So the last two levels are where the real strong connection happens. And you don't jump to this level, right? You don't just jump in and say, oh, I'm adopted, I got a twin brother who died in a car accident. No. You don't jump there. There's levels, right? So you use your professional judgment and you decide, what's correct. So the next level is called gut level. And this is the only level we're gonna share of the last two, because the last one's too personal for this setting. But this is how you really feel about how you're feeling inside, or you feel about something else, right? So it could be you feel passionate about a cause. It could be you feel passionate about a sport or a team. It could be you're really struggling with something in your life, or you're really killing it with something in your life, right? But it's an expression of that emotion inside. You're opening that up and letting people know, because we don't really do that often in life, really share how we're feeling inside, and it's very powerful. So we'll go around. I'll go first. What can I share? I was super excited this week because I got contacted by some folks about a potential script writing sort of freelance that would have paid very well, and I was super excited. And I struggled, and I asked my wife, and I got permission, and she said, okay, we can try it out for a week. And then I wrote back to the guys, and I thought we were going to get started, and they said, we're still auditioning you. You don't have the job. So then I was really disappointed. So now I'm like, you know, trying to struggle to sort of be like, okay, let your ego out of it, you know, just see where this can go and see if it's something you want to pursue. So I had to check my ego a little bit, and I think I am going to pursue the opportunity and see where it goes.
I don't know.
It's hard, right? This is the real deal. This is where it starts to get a little bit harder. You can pass. I'm not going to force anyone to go. We can come back to you if you want. You want to pass?
So wait, what did you say this has to be? This is just you sharing something that's been on your mind this
Something
week?
That you feel, right? Something that you feel strongly about, right?
Huh.
It could be a pet. You could say you love dogs. It could be anything. But something that's real. It's you. It's not just something that you would tell anyone. It's you.
We're going to save it for Umberto for him to get back to and tell
you. Make sure you're done when I'm back,
right? Okay. You need some more time. Casey, you need some more time. Let me know.
Oh, you jump in.
Yeah.
Jump in.
Yeah, we don't want to do it like that.
I'm not, okay.
Yeah, so this is a pretty strong week for me to start off the year because I just had my yearly review. My boss had great feedback, and I knew there wasn't like any chance of not getting good feedback, but I just had a crazy year. I'm working on a big ERP transition project from like an old AS400 system to SAP S/4HANA. I've been really involved in like moving up my responsibilities from being like just like maybe a finance manager who supports the business to really like closing things out where my boss doesn't have to review much. So this past year, I've kind of like struggled like learning things, like getting them done, like closing it out. And then again, with this new project that's completely new to me, and I think through all the challenges that I've had this past year, I've gotten like really comfortable with like my strengths, my weaknesses, and really like understanding my own value. So after my boss like gives me good feedback, I'm like, hey, I love that. But like, here's my value. Like, here's what I know my values at. Like, the owner of the business is coming to town next week from Spain, and like, I just want you to know, I'm about to present to him like my vision for like my next couple years here and where my value's at. And if it doesn't work out, like, I understand like, this is more of a personal thing for me, not necessarily a business decision. But hey, like, I'm going to have this conversation. I'm going to shoot you the slide deck before I shoot it to him. I don't know if you'll have time to really review it because he's knee-deep in SAP transition stuff himself. The Spanish business went live at the beginning of the year. The U.S. business is going to go live in April. So I just had that conversation, and I was like, wow, like, I felt really good. Like, I did it, and I'm also really comfortable that, like, if this upcoming conversation with the CEO is going to sign off on whether my value is met or not, like, I'm really comfortable, like, okay, I could go somewhere else. Like, the job market is so hot right now, and with this past background I've gotten for the past couple of years, like, it's been like a relief and like such a strong feeling to have at this moment.
All right, great. Thanks for sharing. So let's do one or two more.
I recently applied to the state of Texas, a lot of interviews. I think I was in step like 6 of 9. It's really intensive.
Mm-hmm.
It's also my first time ever applying for like a law enforcement position.
Mm-hmm.
I was disappointed. At the same time, I was also a little happy.
Mm-hmm.
Because I feel like I made it pretty far.
Wow.
And I got really intimidated when I would go to, not really the PTs, but the writing. Like, I'm interviewing with like other people who are already police officers.
Yeah.
Who have military experience. Like, people that were in the special forces. And I'm like, I'm not. I take it in stride.
Uh-huh.
I met with my investigation officer later.
Yeah.
So you get assigned a person who investigates you, like your whole background. They call people like in the ER, like my family, like everyone, my teachers from like first, second grade.
Wow.
Yeah.
And he gave me some good advice. He's like, you are a passionate person. Don't take it to heart. Like, a lot of people don't get in the first round.
Yeah.
And if you're really passionate about it, you can go again.
Great.
I also learned a lot about like myself. Because they ask you, like, they're very repetitive questions in interviews, so it's like, why do you want to be, you know, a state trooper? And I'm like, I like to help people, and then it's like, that's just a general cause. So it's like, you know, that general sense, it made me happy. Even though they told me no, it still made me happy because I feel like I learned so much as a person.
Yeah.
I can apply again, and now I'll be able to, you know, go further than that.
All right. Thank you so much for sharing that. We'll take one more just for time's benefit. So one more. Luis.
So for the past few months, I've been leading an effort, Ally Summit, which Evelyn was there. So I was given an opportunity to speak in front of like 150 people, about 100 people. And so I thought I was going to kill it. I didn't prepare, so I was like, yeah, I'm still going to kill it. I feel like I bombed on it. Evelyn destroyed it. She killed it. She did absolutely amazing. But I feel like I lost an opportunity to make a big impact. But on the other hand, I learned so much from that.
Yeah,
because I decided at that point on, I'm going to always prepare when I'm on stage or when I'm going to do a presentation. I'm always going to be prepared. So that was the key thing I learned from that.
Thanks so much, Luis. So, how do you feel about the people who share now? Right? Do you feel a little bit more of a connection, maybe, than before they started sharing that? So you can see there's different levels of power of connection based on what you share, right? A lot of times, like typical coaching will be like, oh, you know, ask a lot of open-ended questions. You know what I feel like when someone asks me a lot of open-ended questions without sharing anything? What do you feel like when someone just peppers you with questions and they don't share?
Interviewed.
Yeah, you feel like you're being interrogated. Interviewed is kind. I feel interrogated, right? Like, when are you gonna talk, right? Why do I have to share everything? So it's a balance, right? You have to be interested in them. You have to ask open-ended questions and interview them. Don't interrogate them. But you also have to share something about yourself. And you can see the different levels of sharing that are possible. And you can move up and down based on what's appropriate for that moment in the conversation. So the last level I'm going to share with you, and we're not going to, you know, share it because it's too personal, is what they call peak level statements. These go to the core of who you are and what you feel.
Why would we not share that?
Why would we not share that? Because I told you, we don't have enough alcohol. It's too early.
It's too vulgar, too many curses.
Do
you
want to get drink? We need drink before we go into that.
Okay. You know, this is the thing when you're in like your dorm room at like, you know, 1 a.m. in the morning and you say, bro, I got a confession to make, you know?
It's like me and Umberto at the National Summit, yeah.
Or like when you're a road trip together, right? When you're road tripping together and you've been in the trenches, you know, and it just kind of comes out. This is like your shields are like totally down. Like this is like pure you. When we talk about vulnerability, this is not something you just tell anyone because they could mess you up with this information, right? There's a high level of trust, right? And with that trust comes a really strong connection. Now, there's a risk, right? No risk, no reward, that person could mess you up with that information. They could react in a way that you were surprised by and reject you and say, oh, I can't believe you would say that or do that. You're a horrible person, right? But that risk has to be there in order for you to get the reward of the stronger connection. Make sense? Okay, so those are the five levels. The first three are transactional. You're in the lobby. You're in orientation, just sharing facts. You're just sharing factual statements about, you know, how you feel about something. And then we get to the deeper stuff where it's like, what's the real emotion behind something? And finally, like that totally unguarded you, right? Those are called peak level statements. And you'll see when you're at an event, you can tell, you'll notice if you feel strongly connected with someone, I guarantee you, you're in levels like 2, 3, and 4. You're not in level 1. You're probably in levels 3 and 4. Right, when you're making that connection. 5 is pretty rare that you actually get there, and it's really not appropriate to be in 5 all the time. That's a little bit stressful for everyone. They're like, stop dropping so much on me, Luis. God, I can't handle it. All right, so that's the first principle. It is to be what? Starts with a V?
Vulnerable.
And no risk?
No reward.
No reward. All right, so definitely try to remember that and use that going forward. The second principle is to be curious. So what do I mean by being curious? So again, I'm going to demonstrate this. If you guys could pair up again. Same thing, just face each other.
Good, I needed that stretch.
I just wasn't sure.
Are you preparing the same?
I think so, yeah.
Right. Oh.
It doesn't matter. You can pair up however you want.
Oh.
Yeah, okay, so pair up.
Do you have some money?
Someone needs a partner there. Maybe you two pair up.
I can pair up.
Yeah.
Right now, so
somebody. Jennifer, I'll pair up with you.
Yeah.
Yeah, everybody's making my life.
Okay, so decide who's gonna go first, all right? And in just a moment, I'm gonna give you directions. We're gonna do something for about 30 seconds. We're gonna switch, and then we're gonna switch again, all right? This is based on an improv type exercise, all right? So in about a few seconds, when I say go, whoever's going first, I want you to just slowly move your arms in any which way you want, right? Just slowly and steady. Don't do it yet, don't do it yet. And I want the person who's going second to be like a mirror and follow you. So if your right hand is moving, their left hand is moving. And do it like synchronized swimming, as closely as you can. Ready, and go. No gap. There should be no gap between leader and follower. Wow, you guys are professionals. Keep it up. Keep it up. A little bit more. I know it feels weird, but we got to feel weird to get there. All right? Keep it up. All right, now I want you to switch, and now the person who was following, I want you to lead. Right? So switch. We're going to do the same thing, but switch. So different leader, different follower. All right? Keep going, looking good. Oh, you guys are fast learners. Keep going, yes. Yes, and in just a second, I'm gonna take us to the last stage. All right, in just a second, when I say go, we're gonna continue to synchronize, but there's no leader and there's no follower. You both have to continuously move, but stay in sync. There's no leader, there's no follower. Just figure it out. On your marks, get set, go. You gotta work together, work together, work together. All right, guys, I've tortured you enough. Have a seat. All right, give yourself a round of applause. So, what does this have to do with being curious? Okay? So, when you are following the person, right? Because we each took a turn as a follower. What were you thinking when you were following? What were you paying attention to?
Just the movement.
Just the movement?
Yeah.
Right? Were you thinking about your Netflix queue?
No.
No. What about everyone else? What were you thinking of when you were following?
Don't mess up.
Don't mess up? Yeah, so don't mess up. So what were you doing because you were thinking not to mess up?
Just focusing.
You were focusing, right? So there's a curiosity, there's an attention that you bring to a moment, which makes a difference, right? I can have a conversation with someone, and within 5 seconds, I'm already thinking about something else. It might be my Netflix queue. It might be I'm hungry. I'm going to have another one of these delicious empanadas. It might be what I'm going to say next to make myself sound so smart and brilliant, right? How often do we actually just really pay attention to what the other person is saying? And the reason why we don't pay attention is sometimes, unfortunately, a lack of curiosity, right? I mean, we're all intelligent people in this room. We can kind of finish each other's. Oh my God, he finished my sentence. He proved my point, right? So you know, people speak slower than your mind runs at a faster click than people are speaking. So you can finish, you know, sometimes, and if you're a more experienced person, you're like a chess grandmaster, and this is a newbie, you know what they're gonna say before they get there. So what do? We check out and we stop listening. We stop paying attention to the nuances of what they're doing. And when that happens, you lose a valuable chance for connection because maybe there's something surprising in there, right? Maybe they may make some move that you never anticipated because they're from a different generation, a different culture, a different gender, a different ethnicity, whatever, right? But when you, go ahead.
I think that's when it comes for you to be humble.
Yes.
And understand
humility.
That maybe they know something that you don't know.
Oh, absolutely.
So you have to listen.
Yeah. Yeah.
Regardless of whether you have more experience.
Yeah.
Because I find that in corporate America a lot. Many high-level executives, they come with this very arrogant attitude, and it kills the mood on people that are very highly intelligent, very capable, with fresh new ideas. You know, and I see it, and you know, I don't want to. There's people I want to be like, people I don't want to be like, and that's one of the things that gets me. It's like when people don't care to listen because they're quote unquote more experienced. So what, you don't have anything else to learn because this, you just don't know.
Yeah. So yeah. You bring up a great point that arrogance is a curiosity killer,
yeah.
Right? If you think you know everything you need to know, you little person can't teach me anything, then you're not going to be curious. And to your point, you may be missing out on a lot of great learnings. They could be giving you a $1 billion idea, right? And then you don't think of it, then they go to some other venture capital firm, they take that idea, they become billionaires, and you're like, man, I just met with that kid. He didn't say anything so brilliant, but maybe he did, but were you listening, right? So that's the key to curiosity. So how do we turn that into a practical skill? I'm gonna share with you a skill that I learned in this negotiation books. Some of you may have read it. It's Chris Voss's Never Split the Difference, right? This is called verbal mirroring, okay? So what I want you to do, well, I'll teach you how to do it first. So there's a couple steps here. And first thing I want to tell you about this is relax when you use it. No one's going to freak out and accuse you of mirroring them, all right? Because when I first learned about this, I was like, that's really weird, all right? It's like, I'm not going to do that. But I've used it with my wife, with my boss, with my son, with my coworkers, whatever. I probably used it with Luis. And it's a helpful thing. It's not like a manipulative thing, and people don't even notice it because it's a normal part of human interaction, but you're just sort of intentionally doing it. So what is verbal mirroring, which is different than the mirroring we were doing just a second ago? So when someone says something and you're learning about them, right, you want to learn a little bit more. Sometimes they just stop, but you want to learn a little bit more, right? Because often it's the second or third time they talk about something, like your interviews, right? Why do they ask you so many times? Because they want to see how your answer changes. Because that's the real answer. Your last answer is the real answer, not the first one. Would you say that's right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it gets closer to the truth, right? So what you're going to do is, in a second, we're just going to do a quick exercise with each other where someone's going to explain a situation, like talk about an experience they had that was great or a vacation that they went on, just a few sentences. And when they pause, we're going to do these following steps. You're going to repeat the last two or three words in their sentence, right? So I could say, oh, on my honeymoon, I went to Tahiti, and it was such a great time. So you would say, such a great time. And you would say it in sort of a low, kind of like, I really want to know more about it voice, right? And then, here's the most important part. Let the silence work. Just be quiet and just see what comes back out, right? And what comes out is really, and this happens in work a lot, like your boss will say, like, I want you to do this. And you think you kind of know, but maybe you don't know, right? But you get clarification and you say, oh, you want me to do the report such and such? And then they say something else. And how often does that totally change your perception of what the task is, right? But if you just assumed you would have worked hours and hours and you bring it to them, they're like, that's not what I wanted. Weren't you listening, right? So it's a clarification. So I want folks to pair up and each person just share like a couple sentences about maybe a recent nice experience they had or where they like to go on vacation. And then I want you to pause, and I want the other person to mirror and just see how that feels and works out. Because we have to do this first, because you're not going to want to go out in the real world and try this. So pair up, and then we'll do that just for a few minutes. Okay?
I like the tracksuit you're playing in the background.
Yeah. Gotta get everyone in the mood. All right, folks, let's finish up. We're going to do a quick debrief. So how did it work? Sorry?
It's tough.
Tough?
Yeah.
Tell us about it.
Just the mirroring piece, because you don't know, like,
these things hide a lot.
Where to mirror, or, like, when to mirror.
Okay.
Yeah.
I know you said the last three things, but it was kind of hard to get the last three things because the gist of it actually happened in the middle.
Okay.
But rather, I ended up asking him something about what he said in the middle of the
conversation. Yeah, you can do that as well.
Okay.
You can do that as well. Okay.
Like, I guess it's over the conversation.
Sorry. What's your question? You said you're really chatty.
Right. So like I overshare, so I feel like he didn't really have a chance to mirror me too much because I was just.
Right. So what's your question?
Like how does that? Is that the way that it's supposed to happen? Like is that what the end goal is supposed to be, or how do you manage?
Well, you can't mirror while you're talking. You can't mirror yourself.
Well, yes.
Right. So what's the solution to that if you want to mirror someone else?
Listen more.
Stop talking. I mean, I'm not trying to be mean. I'm just saying, like, it's kind of like if you talk so much that no one else is saying something, you don't have a chance to learn from them and pull out from them. And don't get me wrong, I think the fact that you're chatty is something people probably enjoy about you. It's probably a strength about you, but you have to balance it, right? Because in excess, then yours is the only voice. And then people feel what was a good thing. Like there's an expression, the dose makes the poison, right? So any sort of thing, milk, good, does a body good. If you drink milk nonstop every day instead of food and drink tons of milk, you're gonna get sick, right? It's not good. So everything has to be in the right proportion, right? So that's kind of.
In all fairness, she had a very interesting topic. So
yeah.
I just wanted to throw that in there.
And there are times where it's your turn, right? And maybe you're supposed to be talking more because you're sharing with someone, you're teaching them something, and you're in that instructor kind of role. But I would say in most situations, it's a back and forth, right? It's not like a broadcast, like you want to get their response and see how they're receiving. Other people.
A question after that, like yeah. Same type of perspective, if you're talking too much or if you're trying to listen, when do you know it's the right time to activate the mirroring?
Yep.
If they're like not, is it like a solid pause, that's when you kind of activate it, or should you wait for a certain like phrase and then activate your mirroring because that's the phrase that you're looking to get more on? I think kind of back to like our conversation,
yeah.
Like, where do you focus in that mirroring?
So you know this, okay? You can sense this.
Okay.
If you've ever had a conversation with someone where the person didn't get mad at you and run away and say, you're so obnoxious, you've already mastered what you've asked about, the skill.
Okay.
You can tell someone pauses,
yeah.
Right? There's a natural pause. And that's actually an invitation for you to come in. Now, if you don't come in at the right time, what are they gonna do?
Keep talking.
They're gonna keep talking, right? So there's a natural, this is actually the last concept we're gonna go over in just a moment, but there's like a natural ebb and flow to the conversation. And what I'm teaching you here, the verbal mirroring, it's not like it's not like a technique that you like pull out like a weapon and you use on people. It's to teach you the concept of that what people say is not always all there is to be said. And it's a sort of technique to learn how to draw more people out. So whether it's the last three sentences or whether it's something in the middle or something, it's that concept. Don't just take what people say at face value. You can learn much more the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth iteration. Does that make sense? So did anyone like feel like, oh my God, I can't believe you're mirroring at me? Did you feel like violently upset about it? Anyone?
No.
It kind of feels normal because we kind of do this anyway, right? Someone says something to me and you'll be like, wait, what? What did you mean about that? So it's just a technique to help you understand the concept. You don't actually have to use the last three words. It's just use that concept to draw more out of people. I recommend you try it at the Meet the Board event when you're meeting new people and they say, oh, I'm so-and-so, I work with this, I'm really excited about this. And you'll be like, oh, you're excited about it? And then they'll explain to you why they're excited. So you can get to that deeper level. Make sense? So what have we learned so far? We've learned two of the connection principles. The first one is be vulnerable, right? And what did we learn about being vulnerable? The five different, what? Five different levels of sharing, right? Or statements you could make, and the effect that the different levels will have on your ability to connect with people. And then we learned about being curious, right? And what did we just learn now about being curious?
Mirroring,
right? And how to sort of learn more about what people really mean underneath maybe that first volley or that first statement they make. And the third thing I like to call be dancing. So I demonstrated this with Luis earlier at his event, but I'm gonna ask Joanna to come up here for a second, if you don't mind.
My dancing wasn't good enough?
Ah! I'm not really good at dipping you, so I'm not going to dip anyone. All right, so what we're going to show here is, and this goes to your point earlier about when to jump in, right? So what I'm going to ask Joanna to do in just a second is I'm going to ask her to just have her hand out, and I'm going to, you know, gently hold onto her wrist, and just for her to follow, if I lead her somewhere, to follow. Now, the only thing you have to do is don't go where I say to go. Don't go where I go. Go where you feel the movement to go, right? So if you don't feel any movement in your wrist, where do you go?
I stay put.
You stay exactly where you are, right? So if you could just put your arm out, all right? So I have her wrist, right? This is like how you might lead someone, right? You might lead someone like, you know, let's go over here together, all
like
right?
When you're dancing.
Yeah, like when you're dancing. That's just be dancing. Very good. All right.
Dan knows all about dancing. All
right. So watch what happens. Joanna, come here. Why aren't you coming here?
You're pushing me away.
But Joanna, I want to go over here. Wait, why are you staying there? I am so tired, Joanna. I want to have a seat. What are you still doing up there? So tell everyone what you're feeling.
Misled?
Yeah, she's feeling nothing here, right? In my mind.
Confused.
Yeah, in my mind, I want to go somewhere, but I'm not actually leading her here, right? Now, if I was and I said, hey, Joanna, let's go over here, she would go. And if she wanted to change, let's say you wanted to turn, so turn, I would go with her too, right? So now it's like a dance. Thank you so much, Joanna. So think about ballroom dancers, right? How do they move so beautifully like one unit? They're two separate people. And even though they've practiced a routine and they got the routine down, there's variables, right? You slip, your timing can get off. There's maybe a bright light blinds you for a second and you stumble. How are they able to continue to move beautifully like one unit? Right? It's because they have that flow between them. They feel the presence of each other through that
connection.
That connection of that. Well, what is this called? Like this shape that they make, right? When they do the ballroom dancing, right? And then they have little signals, right? Like you tap your hands or you move. It's a pressure. Go faster, go slower, go left, go right. It's the same thing in conversation. People are sending you signals all the time. What does this signal mean?
Not talking.
No, right. But I'll tell you, I have this problem. Sometimes I can't control myself, and I got to finish up. Right? Or what does this signal mean? Oh, sorry. It's easier when I sit down, all right? So we're talking, and then you're like.
Interest?
Yeah, I'm interested, right? So what does that mean? That means you've hit on something that they're interested. You have a question.
Can we brand that as the Lewis code?
Oh, he's a very curious cat, Mr. Luis. That's why, right? Yeah, you can tell that. So it's all about dancing. And it also means, as you were saying before, you have to take turns, right? You can't always be the one pushing the conversation. Sometimes you have to pull back and create a space for the other person to share and lead, because then you have a beautiful back and forth. It's a flow rather than a march. You must follow my lead, my steps. I tell you what to do. This is where we're going to go. Does anyone enjoy that kind of conversation? Right? I get like flashbacks to being a child when your parents are like, this is why you have to do this, and this is important. It's not a conversation at that point. It's instruction, mm-hmm. right? And unless you intend to instruct a person, because there's times where you need to, mm-hmm. don't instruct them, because you're not their father. You're not their mother. You're not their professor. They didn't sign up to be instructed. They want to have a conversation with you. But as intelligent people, as people with experience, we often go into professor mode, right? And we say, let me tell you something, right? So what are the three principles we learned? Be
vulnerable.
Second one?
Curious.
Be curious. And the last one?
Dance.
Dancing. So I hope you'll use all of these starting today. When you get back home at the event, to really be able to connect, even with total strangers, if you use these principles, I guarantee you can connect with anyone, anytime, anywhere. So, thank you.